The other example I'd like to point to is the once we did the make decision for Pika, we had to set up a TPS lab. And literally from scratch, I mean, what we had was a large room because the facility at Hawthorne was very large, but we had a large section of the facility with essentially concrete floors, you know, walls, and lights, and that's it. I mean, it was there was nothing in that shop at all. And over the course of 9 months, it went from literally an empty space to a world-class TPS production facility where they were producing four blocks, large blocks of Pika in a big oven at a single time, so a big batch mode, and much better than any of the outside vendors had had developed to that point. So in the course of 9 months, it went from being essentially an empty room to having the best Pika fabrication facility on the planet, 9 months. And again, if you would have told me, based on my NASA experience, you could make that much progress, I would have said no way. You know, maybe 18 months if you pushed really, really hard, but we did it in nine months. So that was quite astounding. So the whole pace of development is just at light speed compared to what you're used to in traditional aerospace. And it really does take a number of months to get used to that, to get used to how rapidly things move, how rapidly decisions are made, the whole, you know, try it and verify, move forward or step back approach, and the whole collaborative design environment between the different subsystems. Again, one of the design approaches SpaceX uses is rapid prototyping and test and failure. And I'll give you one example that actually I thought was quite interesting. One of the times we had a little difficulty between two groups had to do with the temperature limit that we were looking at for the bonding agent for the Pika heat shield to the structure. And we were given a number from the structures group that looked low, that they wanted, you know, we had to specify that the bond was below a certain temperature. And we were suspicious that that number was too low. And so we went and talked to the structures group and said, oh, no. I still remember the gentleman saying that composite structure that they're using for the carrier structure for the TPS, it turns to butter above this temperature. And myself and another gentleman were walking away, and we said, we don't believe that. And this gentleman actually was Andrew Chambers. He said, we're going to test this. And we had this big oven that we made the Pika billets, and it could go up beyond the temperature that we wanted to actually use and way beyond the temperature they said was the limit of this composite. So Andrew actually was able to go get some samples of this composite. We set up a jig, okay, and this took like, you know, one day, okay. So we got these samples. We set up a jig in the oven where we highly loaded these samples so that they were under great strain at room temperature, okay. Went out of the oven, closed the door, and cranked up the temperature. Okay, so we first cranked it up to the point where the gentleman said, this turns to butter. And what we would do is that we'd open the oven, run in and measure the deflection, because it's hot in there, and then run back out and close it again. And so we first got to the temperature where we said it turned into butter, okay, and they hadn't budged at all. And then we went up to the temperature that we wanted to use, and they had budged a little bit, but hardly at all, okay. So then we went back to this gentleman, okay, in the composites group and said, well, you know, we just ran a test relative to these limits you're giving us. It didn't turn to butter at this temperature. You know, it looks like it's fine up to this. And that's when the gentleman said, but we just can't trust you guys. So they were giving us an artificially low temperature because they were worried that we would violate that temperature limit. But what actually brought that to light was this rapid prototyping. We literally did this in a day, okay, with the things that we had available, okay. Just we went and did it and just, okay, you said that it turns to butter here. We're going to check that and see if it does or doesn't, you know, and it didn't. And that's an example of how they work, okay. If someone gives them a requirement or some type of a parameter, they are prone, well, let's see if that's the case or not. Let's put together a jig. Let's put together an apparatus to see if we verify what we've been told. Does it work this way or not? And they can do it very, very rapidly. And what happens is that you're able to learn very quickly. And For example, another one that we did on the way to scaling up Pika, when we to go from essentially an empty room to a world-class, you know, Pika shop, Pika factory, we did it in three phases. We first did first phase, prototype phase of things about the size of a coffee cup, just so we could transfer the process to the SpaceX team. Okay, here's how you make Pika on small scale. Then we had to go to a scale-up of a full-size billet, but we did that with a prototype unit, and because we had some concerns about temperature requirements and uniformity. And so we built a prototype unit. It took us about 3 months, but we built a custom furnace that we could monitor very accurately the temperatures, the state of the material in the device. And after doing several billets out of that, we were able to then go and design the full-scale facility. But it was going through and very quickly doing, you know, try this, does it work, okay, learn, go to the next size, go to the next size. And at each step, we learned very important things, that were things that were working, things that weren't working, things to watch out for. We had a couple gotchas on the full-scale billet prototype that we were able to resolve. We were seeing some funny behavior for a while on how some of the solvent that's part of the process on how it was modifying the phenolic. And we were scratching our heads for a couple of weeks, and we ran some tests and found out what it was and modified the approach and got it to work on a full-scale billet. And by the way, I should mention that was the first time that anyone had ever done a full-scale Pika billet. Even the outside suppliers had not ever accomplished a full-scale billet, and we were able to do that through this prototyping. But yeah, doing that rapid prototyping and testing, it allows you to identify, you know, what's important, what are the things that you don't know about that are going to bite you, and address them early on before you go to a full-scale facility where now if you have a problem, now the options you have to fix a problem are far fewer and far more costly than at a smaller scale. So that was one thing that you'd see over and over again. They do it on all sections. I saw that in the TPS area, but they do it for structures. They do it for engines. They try to prototype at the smallest scale that they can initially and then work their way up to full scale and do it as rapidly as possible with 51% confidence at each step along the way.